3, 2, 1.
Asha!
I'm here. Whew, just one second. Let me catch my breath.
Imagine a world where magic exists and wishes can come true. Well, some of them. Very few, actually. Kind of like winning the lottery. And partaking in the lottery also comes at a steep price. Would you still want to live in such a world? Hi there, it's Micha. If you'd like to hear more about this, then join me for this review video. In the Kingdom of Rosas, King Magnifico, a great sorcerer, grants his subjects their heart's greatest desire. One person at a time, one time per month. Everyone in the kingdom is eligible, but the downside? To be considered, their wish has to be extracted from their hearts, resulting in them forgetting what that wish even was. Magnifico, keeping their wishes safe, believes that forgetting their dreams means taking a burden from their shoulders. While looking for an apprentice, he interviews Asha, a young girl who hopes her now 100-year-old grandfather would get his wish granted soon. She soon learns, though, that Magnifico only grants wishes that serves his kingdom and don't threaten his reign. As Asha's grandpa wants to be an inspiring musician, the king deems this a dangerous wish, as inspiring others might lead to his people revolting against him. Realizing that most wishes will never be made true, Asha asks Magnifico to give those back to his subjects, so that they can remember them and can work on making them reality on their own. Which he refuses to do, again, to not threaten the status quo.
It's not fair. They deserve more than—
I decide what everyone deserves.
Disillusioned, she wishes on a star for her fellow people to get a better life than this. And soon a star appears to help her reach that goal.
Last night, I made a wish on a star. And the star answered.
Somebody, Valentino, don't eat that!
It didn't work. When does the magic happen, huh?
Can Asha, together with her friends and with the help of Star, save the kingdom? Another great Disney animated movie that tells not only a cute story kids can enjoy, but also asks the question if we would be better off not knowing our dreams or keep trying to make them reality eventually, even though we may never reach those goals.
People come here because they know they can't make their own dreams come true. The journey is too hard, it is too unfair. They give their wishes to me willingly, and I make it so they forget their worries.
It also showcases how someone like Magnifico, who started it all coming from a good place in his heart, can lose their way and turn into a tyrant without even realizing it in the early stages. The downside here, like in many movies in recent times, and especially in Disney movies, is the message around being a villain, which seems to be this. Once you turn evil, there is no way back. You will either be locked away forever, be killed, or have to sacrifice your own life in the end to find redemption. As you may know from my other reviews, I'm a sucker for a redemption arc, which unfortunately most movies deny their villains. Here, a plotline even states that once dark magic is used, there is no coming back. Doesn't mean that redemption can't occur in the future, but chances are slim. Especially considering that there will likely be no sequel, as the movie so far bombed at the box office. It could still grow legs like the most recent Pixar movie, Elemental, did, which started slow but turned into a sleeper hit. But the chances for that are also slim.
I have no response to that.
I just hope the reason for people staying away from this movie is not that the lead character is black. But you never know. For sure, the lack of PR work due to the actor strike is a factor. And maybe some people are boycotting Disney in general at the moment. We will never know for sure. In any case, the movie didn't deserve to tank. So if you like Disney movies, check this one out. It may not reach the sphere of, let's say, Frozen, but it is very enjoyable and has plenty cute as well as heartfelt moments. And I love Valentino, the little goat, voiced by Alan Tudyk.
I'm talking, I am talking. Who knew my voice would be this low?
who has voiced a character in every animated Disney movie since 2012's Wreck-It Ralph.
I'm King Candy! That's right!
The Duke of Weaseltown.
Weaselton!
No, no, you can't!
It's Weaselton! Duke Weaselton. Umbrella, Umbridge, Umami.
You tricked us.
A waiter! There's a cop in my cap!
Sometimes, if the movie doesn't present a proper role for him as a white male, he was voicing speechless animals, like Hei Hei in Moana or Tuk Tuk in Raya and The Last Dragon. Here, he has a larger speaking role again, and he totally delivered.
It's a dead end.
With unsanded mahogany.
Oh, good find, Valentino.
My butt found it.
I also enjoyed the fact that this film, celebrating 100 years of Disney movies, references many other animated Disney classics in its plot, some quite obviously, like Pinocchio and Wishing on a Star, some in pictures, like Peter Pan as a character dressed similarly, wished to be able to fly, and some more subtle. In the end credits, almost all movies were represented chronologically, by one character made out of stars showing up there. They skipped the early, more episodic ones though, from Saludos Amigos, through The Three Caballeros, Make Mine Music, Fun and Fancy Free, to Melody Time. For reasons unknown, they also left out The Rescuers and The Black Cauldron, though the latter, back then almost killing the animated branch of a studio, may have been left out for that reason. They also skipped sequels like, again, The Rescuers Down Under, 2011's Winnie the Pooh, Ralph Breaks the Internet and Frozen 2. Though they included Fantasia 2000. Meet the Robinsons was also missing, but with some stars blinking in its stead. I'm not remembering the movie well enough to say if that may be a reference to it in itself though. And with that being said, let's get to the rating, but before we go there, let me ask you to like and share this video if you enjoyed it so far, and if you're not a subscriber yet, maybe consider to change that. By also hitting the notification bell, you will get a heads up for most of my new videos. Now for the rating. I enjoyed this movie a lot, and I think it walked the line between paying homage and pandering to nostalgia pretty well. I had to get used to the computer animations trying to emulate hand-drawn images at first though, as that resulted in less fluid imagery than we are used to today, which may distract some viewers a bit at times. The movie had cute characters that kids will likely want to have on various merchandise items, which is a win-win situation. Voice acting was strong and some of the songs, though not as instantly memorable as in Frozen, may eventually find their way into our Spotify playlists.
You're a star!
Yeah. I'm rating it with 8.5 out of 10 points. Maybe not the best movie Walt Disney Animation Studios ever put out, but a great one that grown-ups can enjoy and kids will love. So if you haven't watched it yet and generally like the animated Disney entries, make sure to check it out. Especially since it is screened in native 3D and nowadays most movies don't make it to Blu-ray in 3D anymore. What about you? Have you seen this movie? Are you planning to still see it in the theater, later at home, or not at all? And if so, what turned you away from it? Whatever you like to share, let me know in the comments. So much for now, see you next time, and thanks for watching! As that resulted in less fluid imagery than we are used to today. In less fluid. Voice acting was strong and some of the songs, though not as instantly memorable, trying to emulate hand-drawn images at first though.